I have 1:05 Eastern Standard Time on my side, so I think we'll go ahead and get started. I'm Chris Whatley, Executive Director of the Halo Trust USA, and I just want to thank everybody for making time to join us today to talk about the Solomon Islands, a corner of the world you probably don't have as much time to think of in the midst of all the other competing major international crises going on, but a really critically important place in terms of human impact and our own history and story as Americans. So from my side, like most of you, I'm guessing, who have not thought of the Solomon Islands much, for me, it was probably something that's kind of a distant memory from high school history class. But I will say there's one story that I can recall that very much puts the Solomon Islands in my frame. And that's the story of a young Navy lieutenant from a prestigious Boston family who, on one dark night in the midst of World War II, had his patrol torpedo boat cut in half by a Japanese destroyer, and who was then saved by brave local islanders and worked with those islanders to save his own crew from death and captivity. You know, that's a story that ends in the White House. That's the story of John F. Kennedy. And, you know, for us, that becomes part of that broader narrative of American Camelot. It's just the first page of that book. But one thing that I never thought of, and I don't think very many Americans have, is what happened to those characters in the story that saved our future president. Well, not much. Camelot didn't come to the Solomon Islands. At the end of the war, we just left. And we left behind a massive store of explosives that are killing people to this day. And we're really fortunate to be joined by Simon Conway, my amazing colleague, someone who is a former soldier, a current and future author, and a huge Halo leader who develops new programs for us. Once upon a time, served as our acting CEO, who probably knows Halo better than anybody else I can think of, and therefore knows the challenges of helping communities overcome deaths by explosives, for helping communities become clear of these devices, whether they're from World War II or whether they're from the contemporary conflicts we have right now. So I'm just delighted to have you with us, Simon, and I will turn it over to you.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for your kind words. I can, if we can start the slideshow now, that would be great. Okay, the Halo Trust in the Solomon Islands. In the summer of 2022, the United States Department of State issued a notice of funding opportunity to undertake survey of unexploded Second World War ordnance in the Solomon Islands. I visited the islands in August of that year and frankly was shocked by what I saw. Very high levels of contamination and no information about the extent of the problem or the harm it was causing. I wrote a proposal for the State Department and was successful in securing the funding. Since January of this year, I've been involved in setting up and running the project. And I'm going to talk to you today about what I found and what Halo is doing about it. Next slide, please. So first of all, where is the Solomon Islands? And it's a question that I get asked frequently. As you can see, it's to the northeast of Australia and at the tail end of Papua New Guinea. It includes over 900 islands over a 1,500-kilometer frontage. That's about 930 miles. It is a strategically important location because if you control the airfields and the deep water ports, you can cut off the western coast of the USA from its allies, Australia and New Zealand. And that's what the Japanese were intending when they captured the islands in early 1942. And it's why the United States and its allies fought so hard to recapture them. It's also why Solomon Islands are again the focus of great power interest. Next slide, please. So this map shows the extent of Japanese imperial expansion at the beginning of the war. That red line is as far out as the Japanese got. And the red stars show the locations of battles, of both land and sea battles, as the United States seized back control of the Central and Southern Pacific. The land battles were savage, involving naval, air, and artillery bombardment, close quarter fighting with mortars and grenades, creating a legacy of unexploded ordnance that continues to this day. In addition, a large number of ammunition depots were built to enable the combatants to move bombs and shells closer to the front lines. And in many cases, these depots were abandoned or they blew up because of the difficulty of keeping them safe and secure. I mean, just an interesting one on naval bombardment. If you look at Tarawa, just down in the sort of southeast of that map, yeah, there you go, it's getting pointed out. So about 40% of Japanese casualties there were before HR, before the attack began, during what was an absolutely pummeling naval bombardment. And of course, in those circumstances where you might see failure rates of 10 to 20%, you will have very large numbers of unexploded ordnance littering that former battlefield. And it's true across the South and Central Pacific. Next slide, please. So here's the Solomon Islands, the nation of the Solomon Islands, but also Bougainville up there in the northwest, which is actually part of Papua New Guinea. So it's the Shortland Islands, which is the sort of boundary between Solomon Islands and Bougainville. The black lines on that map show how the Americans advanced steadily through 1942 when they landed on Guadalcanal down there in the larger island there. In the center, and then advanced up through the Russell Islands to the New Georgia Islands, big battles on the New Georgia Islands, as well as Guadalcanal, and then beach landings up at Shortland Islands. Now, the green and the blue dots show the locations of where unexploded ordnance, that's you know, the range of different shells, bombs, etc., that have been found. That's where they've been found and destroyed from 2011 up until now. We simply don't have any records before 2011, but I think we have to assume a lot of ordnance was cleared before 2011, and there's a lot of ordnance has been found subsequent to 2011, and those dots often indicate multiple numbers of UXO, and it gets very dense there on Guadalcanal and up at Munda on New Georgia Island. Certainly more than about 50,000 items have been found and destroyed since 2011. Next slide. So what are we finding? Well, there on the left, you've got a 650-pound US aircraft bomb. We know from the National Archives here in DC, that it's one of 96 that were dropped on a ridgeline in Guadalcanal in 1942, and that the pilots observed and recorded, and it's like I said, it's in the National Archive, that five of them didn't explode. So that's one of them, which probably means there's another four up there in the forest for us to find in future. And then on the right, you can see artillery shells, pretty bad state. Often the Japanese, those are both Japanese artillery shells, often the Japanese had to carry them through the jungle as they tried to recapture the airfields and take back positions from the Americans. They were diseased, they were hungry. Often they left them by the side of jungle trails. So we often find piles of ordnance like this by the side of jungle trails. Next slide, please. And then hand grenades and mortars. Now we find a lot of these on the ground everywhere we go. So up in the top left there, those are US hand grenades, and down in the bottom right, those are Japanese hand grenades. Next slide, please. So just to give you a sense of the scale of contamination, this is a map of Honiara, the capital of Guadalcanal, of the Solomon Islands, and the largest city in the Solomon Islands. Honiara there on the left, and then Henderson Airport on the right. That's the international airport, but it's also what was Henderson Airfield. That was the prize. That was what the Japanese and the Americans fought over. Every one of those yellow dots is where unexploded ordnance has been found and destroyed by the Royal Solomon Islands Police Force. Now, the Police Force have a bomb disposal team. They're probably the best ones in the South Pacific. And that's them responding to call outs and destroying items. It's important to note, though, that that is essentially reactive. It relies upon the public phoning the police number and reporting the ordnance. The reporting tends to go up after an accident and then tends to fall away again afterwards. And it doesn't mean that the areas to the south of the city where there are no dots are actually free of UXO. It just may be that no one's been there or they haven't bothered phoning it in. Now, the blue dots show where Halo has found and reported items to the police since June, and they've come out and destroyed them. It's the beginning of a more proactive response where we go out and look for UXO rather than waiting for it to be called in. Now, it's obviously early days. We've only been on the ground doing the survey for 4 to 5 months. And this is it's something that we're doing during the course of the surveys, finding ordnance on the ground. Now, next slide, please. So I had a look at the police records of all that ordnance that they cleared, and it turned out that 80% of it was from the United States, 17% of it from Japan, and then a smaller mixture of Australia, France, and the United Kingdom. I think it's probably a reflection of the fact that the US simply had more ammunition, and that's really why they won. And you can look at what's going on in Ukraine at the moment, and you understand it's about the logistics of getting as much ammunition into place as possible. And in this case, the US produced ammunition on industrial levels and shipped it out to the Solomon Islands where it was used to seize back the islands. So what is the consequences of all this ordnance? Really, what it means is people interact with it on a daily basis. Next slide, please. So back in May, when we were first sort of setting up the program, and before we really strictly started work, I was up in a place called Bacona. It's only about 5 minutes' drive from the center of Honiara, from the center of town. It's a little ravine. It's known as the ravine, but it's a squatter camp, essentially. It's an informal settlement, lots of people living up there. And it was the site of some very severe fighting back and forth. And it's heavily contaminated with unexploded ordnance. So I stopped by the side of the road. I spoke to an adult standing by the side of the road and said, have you finding any ordnance down in the river at the bottom of the ravine? And within, I would say, 2 or 3 minutes, I was surrounded by a crowd. And one of them, Bernard, who's there on the left, Bernard walked out of the crowd and handed me the hand grenade on the right. A Japanese type 91 rifle grenade. I took it from him because I didn't really have any choice and put it down by the side of the road. And we then waited for the police to come out and destroy it. But that's the kind of situation that we find ourselves in. And of course, we spoke to him about not picking things up, but there's certainly a requirement for more of that kind of messaging to particularly curious young kids, because if you look at the statistics around the entire world, curious young, particularly boys, are very vulnerable to blowing themselves up on unexploded ordnance because they like to pick up and play with shiny things. Next slide, please. So this was more recent. Reverend David Arakana, the head of the United Church up in New Georgia in the Western province, and his kids had dug up underneath his house. That's his house behind. You can see the pillars. His kids had dug up a shell and moved it over to this tree. Now, the shell is one of the more dangerous items that we've been finding in the Solomon Islands. It's a naval shell, 5-inch US naval shell, fired by a ship. But it has a mechanical time fuse, essentially a fuse that is supposed to be ticking down to zero, at which point it then explodes. But for whatever reason, it stopped moving. The copper, clockwork element in it has not worked. But that doesn't mean to say if you don't move it, shift it, it wouldn't start again and explode. So again, we phoned the police and they came out and dealt with it. Next slide, please. Now, it doesn't always end so well. One of the biggest concerns I have about the Solomons is there's no data about the number of casualties or what they were doing at the time of the accident. And that's made it very hard for the Solomon Islands government to draw attention to the scale of the problem. And from being there, you know, so really it's just anecdotal evidence. There's no database, there's no stats. But from being there, I know of four people who died in 2021 as a result of barbecues. So in the first incident, this is Doreen Noda. I spoke to her back in June. Her son Charlie and his friend Rasif Hilly, both of them, you know, important members of society. I mean, Charlie was had been a Chevening scholar. Rasif was a mechanical engineer. They were attending a church fundraising barbecue, and they were standing beside the pit where the food was cooking when a shell, which must have been just under the surface of the pit, exploded. And they were both immediately killed. And that was, of course, was a great loss to the Solomon Islands. It was lucky because it had, I think it, what Doreen told me, and she saw it happen from under the shelter of a nearby house. And the reason she wasn't standing next to the pit was because it had begun to rain. And so there were only two of them standing close to the pit at that time. So it could have been considerably worse. Next slide, please. So this is the second incident that I found out about in 2021. I was south of Honiara up on a hillside, a small community there, and we met this guy, Abel Jackson, his father-in-law, John Manele, and a 10-year-old boy called Dominic Navaria died again when a barbecue exploded in 2021. And they built the barbecue from two lengths of pipe with a metal sheet across them. And the police investigation concluded that one of the lengths was a pipe bomb. So a length of metal with explosives inside, probably used as a breaching charge. So you put it underneath barbed wire or something and it would then blow up and clear the route for an attack. But they had literally picked that up, built a barbecue out of it, and two people died. That is in the immediate vicinity of Honiara while I was going about other business. So my belief is the number of casualties per year is probably significantly higher than those four. There really is a strong requirement for us to find out more details about casualties as a result of UXO, unexploded ordnance, where they happened, what people were doing at the time of the accident. And therefore, we can then begin to target those communities that are most affected and engage in risk education when we try and persuade them not to undertake some of these activities. But quite hard, I think, to say to someone, well, you can't dig a barbecue pit in your garden. People, particularly when they've been living with a problem for 80 years. So it's challenging circumstances. Now, the contamination in the next slide, please. The contamination in the Solomon Islands is not just confined to the surface. It's actually most of it is under the surface. So when artillery shells land, they often plow into the ground and you'll find them, you know, 15, 20 centimeters or even further sometimes down. Aircraft bombs can be several feet down. And in some cases where defending forces have built firing pits where they put guns, they would store their ammunition, you know, underground. And that means you've got a lot of ammunition that is below the surface of the ground. So, you know, most of those 50,000 plus items that have been found by the police have been on the surface. But that is a fraction of what is actually out there. Now, this is a picture of the Pacific Games Stadium. The games, which is kind of the Olympics for the Pacific, are due to start next month in November. And this is their brand new stadium that they've built. But prior to building it, they had to remove the unexploded ordnance from below the site. Can you show me the next slide? So this is a map of the clearance by a local company, local Solomon Islands run company, of the Pacific Games Stadium site. And it's an area of about 60,000 square meters. That's about 15 and a half acres. And they dug down into it using detectors and the kind of classic methods that we use during what we call battle area clearance. And they found more than 8,000 items. That's everything from cannon rounds to artillery shells. And that just gives you, and that's right, pretty much midway between the airfield and the center of Honiara, center of town. So it just gives you a sense of what lies beneath and the challenge ahead to rid the Solomon Islands of unexploded ordnance. Next slide, please. So what are we in HALO doing about it? This is one of our staff members, Asina Akizama. She is holding a Trimble, which is a kind of differential GPS with a accuracy of 30 centimeters or 12 inches. And we're surveying hazardous areas so that they can be cleared in the future. And we're using differential GPS so we can accurately delineate the boundaries of hazardous areas, creating shapes or what we call polygons. And I'll show you some polygons in a minute. And we're also classifying them by land use. So we're helping the government to decide which elements need to be cleared first. So next slide, please. So this is Bloody Ridge. This is one of the iconic battles of Guadalcanal. We're looking south from just on the edge of the right of the airfield across a ridgeline that was fought over for two nights in September 1942. The Japanese came from the east. They marched for several days through the jungle, and then they attacked from the south up onto this ridgeline. And they vastly outnumbered the Americans famous Colonel Edson, who created his last stand up there on the hillside. And over those two nights, they managed to fight off the Japanese. And it's now really a memorial site to that battle where thousands died. And it's in the process of being turned into a national park. The local authority, the tourist authority of the Solomon Islands, wants to turn it into a national park. But there's never been any subsurface clearance, and we know that there was very heavy fighting. We know that from where that picture was taken, they were throwing hand grenades down that hill. We know that from where those houses are, that there were heavy artillery strikes from both the Japanese and from the Americans. There were airstrikes. There were, you know, hand-to-hand fighting. So we certainly suspect that there's a large quantity of unexploded ordnance below the surface of the ground that really needs to be clear in order for it to be safe. And I'll show you what we've done. So next slide, please. Okay, so this is HALO's survey of Bloody Ridge. The orange line that goes from north to south, that's the top of the ridge line. Each one of those white numbers is an individual polygon, an individual shape, an area that requires clearance. You see the Lunga River there to the west. The yellow dots show where unexploded ordnance has been found and destroyed already on the surface, and the blue dots show where HALO, during the course of mapping these polygons, during the course of it, we found ordnance ourselves. Now, the color coding, just to explain what it is. So red areas are areas that are being used for housing or cultivation. So they're a priority and that people are living there, moving through them, using them. The orange area is community facilities. So the top of the ridgeline is a community owned national park. And the yellow area is what's going to be the new car park when they build, when they create the national park. And then the sort of more, the much less, the sort of pale yellow area is not in use, but people are transiting through it. And the advantage of this is that, that we can then say to the government, we can say, okay, you have this many square meters of land that is people are living in and is being cultivated. You've got this many areas of land that are, you know, public facilities. That might be schools, that might be community centers, that might be water resources, infrastructure, or, you know, in this case, a national park. And then also areas for development, you know, in this case, car park, but in many cases, it's housing, you know, for the future of Honiara as it expands. And that, that allows the government to actually think strategically about what it wants to clear and where it wants to clear. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is just sort of coming out a bit. So zooming out from Bloody Ridge, which is at the bottom center there, this is the Lunga perimeter. That red dotted line shows where the Americans dug in to hold. So they snatched the airfield from the Japanese in August 42, and then they built a perimeter around the airfield. And you can see the airfield there running, you know, running from left to right, from southwest to northeast. The Americans dug in and they held it through until late 1942, when the Japanese finally gave up trying to recapture it. You've got Bloody Ridge there in the center, one of the big, like I said, one of the big battles in September 1942 to try and recapture the airfield. And then up in the to the east, right on the edge of the perimeter by the sea, you've got what's called Alligator Creek, although of course it was crocodiles in that creek rather than alligators, but the US Marines called it Alligator Creek. And it was the site of a very fierce battle between the Japanese, who were trying to come along the coast to grab the airfield. And that was in August 42, so before Bloody Ridge. You can see there, red polygons, that shows, again, like I said, areas where people are living or there's cultivation. So what we would consider very high priority. There's also a purple area there you can see on the east of the map. That is an area, we call it priority 1D. That is an area where we know explosive harvesting is taking place. So that means that the local people are usually using hacksaws, are cutting open, or sometimes screwdrivers, getting into the shells and extracting the explosives, which they're then selling to fishermen who are building improvised bombs, which they're using to stun and kill fish, and which they're also in the process of destroying the pristine reefs of the Solomon Islands. So it's very destructive. So one of the things we're trying to do is identify which areas are the most, you know, problem, because we know there's large amounts of ordnance there. And we're identifying them so that clearance can take place sooner rather than later. Of course, clearing that probably will move the problem elsewhere, but it's going to be a kind of game of cat and mouse where we work out where they're doing it, as well as, frankly, working with the local communities to show them that it really is a big problem. I mean, down in that area, again, talking 2021, I know of at least four people that died during harvesting of explosives. One of them on Christmas Eve 21 was two locals digging into mortar shells that turned out to be white phosphorus, so not regular explosives, an incendiary. They were very badly burned and both died on arrival in hospital. So again, you know, we don't know enough yet about the number of people that die as a result of explosive harvesting, but anecdotally, it's probably the biggest single cause of death in the Solomon Islands. So in addition to the reds and the purples and the oranges, you've got an area of yellow over there to the west, which is again on the perimeter, on that on the Lunga perimeter, we call it, because it's the Lunga Peninsula, the Lunga River. That's an area that the National Provident Fund of the Solomon Islands came to us and said, look, we want to build housing there. Can you please go up and do a survey of it? So we went up there and surveyed what we think are the areas that will require subsurface clearance. And then finally, you've got green polygons. You haven't seen these before. Green polygons show where clearance has actually taken place. So this is local companies. In some cases, perhaps around the airport, it's international commercial companies, or they've, and in some cases, those commercial companies have subcontracted the local commercial companies. But those are areas that have been cleared by local people, most of whom are ex Solomon Islands Police Force. They're part of that bomb. They were retired members of that bomb disposal unit. So there is a capacity at work there, but it's very much, at the moment, it's pretty much dedicated to infrastructure. So you've got the Pacific Games sites over there on the left. Some of the other sites around the river are where they wanted to get gravel for the building. And then you've got around the airfield itself. So there hasn't really been any clearance of sites for humanitarian benefit, as in, you know, people living with shells under their houses in their gardens. And that's something that really needs to happen. Now, I wanted to show you this map, but the next slide will show you the ordnance that we found during our period on survey. So next slide, please. So as you can see, we have found items in Alligator Creek, Tanaru, down in Bloody Ridge, below to the southeast of Bloody Ridge. Also, just south of the airfield. Now, so there are six dots there south of the airfield, but that accounts actually for 150 separate items of unexploded ordnance that we found in the grass just the other side of the fence next to the runway. So just extraordinary levels of contamination. I mean, 80 years old, 150 items just lying around right next to the airfield. The dots up there on the coast, is that's where our home is. That's where our house is. When I was last there, 11 shells washed up on the beach one morning, 11 artillery shells. So there's a lot of ordnance there. We are working to find it and report it to the police. And we're doing this with one team, an 8-person team, of which the survey team is 5 people. With a vehicle, and they're getting around and doing this work. I'll show you the next slide, which is going to swamp it. There you go. That's all the ordnance that's been found within the Lunga perimeter. And so you can see that that's since 2011. And clearly, you know, we have a lot of work to do. And if we're really going to sort of make the best of this, we need more survey teams, frankly. And then, of course, in due course, we want to start clearing ourselves. We want HALO clearance teams on the ground in support of the local population, particularly in support of those areas where people are living, subsisting, having to dig the ground to plant their crops. So that's a sort of overview of the Solomon Islands. And the work that we're doing on the survey to really try and quantify the scale of the problem. And next slide, please. That's a Sina with a young girl that we met on the Russell Islands. Chris was with me at the time. An abandoned, one of the largest coconut plantations in the Southern Hemisphere, abandoned for 20 years. Local people going in there and harvesting copra. But there's also huge amounts of unexploded ordnance in amongst the trees. It was a major ammunition depot. So we were over there surveying the location of ordnance and talking to local people, including this young girl. So I'm happy to answer any questions. Chris, over to you.
Thank you, Simon. And we've got a few questions that have already come in. One you've dealt with a little bit, but perhaps you can speak to it some more. And it's with regard to the fish bombers. You mentioned that we're working in some areas where there's harvesting, but maybe you could speak to the fish bomber issue and how that threatens people and also the environment.
Yeah, so the real problem is that if you use explosives to stun and kill fish, you can create a very large catch. And we're talking, you know, hundreds of US dollars, in some cases, thousands of US dollars. And that means that it's very hard to prevent that happening. So a lot of these fishing communities are, you know, they do the fish bombing, they pull in the fish and they sell them to local businessmen. And often the fish goes overseas to China, predominantly. Because they need the explosives, an industry has kind of grown up whereby local people in villages that are contaminated will dig out the explosives for them. And then when the fishermen come to those communities, they'll sell them to it. So there's a marketplace for explosives in Solomons. And then they also use cannon rounds to create the detonators. They tend to fill like soy sauce bottles with explosives. They're not huge. But then, yeah, they can get a big, you know, big harvest of fish. It absolutely trashes the coral. You know, it kills, sort of roe, baby fish, everything up to porpoise, you know, dolphins. I mean, it's very, very damaging to the ecosystem. And at the moment, the law in the Solomon Islands, it's forbidden, but the penalties are very low, and it's certainly worth risking the financial penalties because the financial rewards are so much larger. So a lot of the communities that are involved in fish bombing and places like the island of Malaita, we're trying to kind of slowly build relationships with those communities so that we can talk to them about, get the data about quite how many accidents they're having, and also talk to them about, you know, the danger of it. At the same time, we're lobbying the government to make the penalties more severe. And then we're also saying to the international community, these people need alternative livelihoods. You know, they could actually be paid to plant mangroves, to restore the reefs, etc., and that would be part of climate mitigation of the efforts that we make to make the Solomon Islands more resilient in the face of the changing climate. So that's, you know, that's something that we're also arguing in favor of, because it would provide employment and it would stop the destruction of this pristine ecosystem.
We have a second question that's about data, and you certainly in your presentation showed us a number of data points, particularly from 2010 on forward. Is there a national database or a system to record all this data that we're producing?
So we have a database that we are feeding information into, but we're also in discussion with the Solomon Islands government, with the Ministry of Police, National Security, about setting up a national database, and our information management team in headquarters, but also in the Solomon Islands, is talking to the government, but we're also talking to the Geneva Center for Humanitarian Demining, who provide something called IMSMA, which is the Information Management System for Mine Action. It's a long acronym, but essentially it's a national database. So we are essentially the custodians of the national database, but everything, all our information has been set up in such a way that it will be automatically ported across to the national database when it's up and running. And that will happen, you know, in the next few months.
Excellent. The next question is, why didn't the US clean this up after the war? Why is this happening now and not 80 years ago?
I mean, it's an interesting question. Most of the clearance efforts that seem to have happened after the war were by the Australians, who obviously are close by. US Pacific Command has over the years provided clearance support, particularly underwater, you know, because it's not just shells on the ground. And we're, you know, as HALO, we're concentrating on on the stuff on the land, but actually there's been quite a bit of assistance with underwater clearance, and the US paid for the training of the police bomb disposal team. So they've done a fair bit, but it needs to be on a much bigger scale. And I think part of the problem, going back to my first point, is that the lack of data, the lack of mapping, the lack of any information made it very difficult. And the US struggled to find a partner that they could work with to properly survey it. So I think it's a good question to ask. I don't have a simple answer to it. What I am very pleased about is something's being done about it now.
Well, you mentioned capacity. So we have a question about, okay, if funding from the US government weren't a limitation, and of course it always is, and knowing what you know, you've only seen, a certain amount of the challenge before you, Simon, but what kind of capacity would be needed? How many deminers would you have to train? What would an ideal program look like in the Solomon Islands?
I mean, I think if we were really going to address, that massive contamination on Guadalcanal, that area to the west of those islands, to the west of Guadalcanal, the Russell Islands, up in New Georgia, the Battle of Munda Point. I mean, 30,000 US troops fought 8,000 Japanese troops through the jungle. There's huge amounts of ordnance up there. Beach landings at the Shortland Islands. If you could spread teams all across the archipelago. I'm hoping that we will, speed up the survey, get more survey teams. We'll hopefully get 50, 100 staff in the course of the next 18 months. Ultimately, if we really want to clear all of the land, then I don't see why it couldn't be a program as large as our program in Cambodia or Laos, where we're talking more than 1,000 staff, men and women, on their hands and knees, getting rid of ordnance. And then you could actually, over the course of a few years, rid the Solomon Islands, of the most dangerous, elements of the problem. We're still going to find stuff for years to come, and that's the same in Britain, where we were heavily bombed during the Second World War. It's the same in Germany, which was heavily bombed in the Second World War. And I looked at the stats for the UK and Germany, and the UK, there's no record of anybody dying as a result of unexploded ordnance dropped during the Second World War since the 70s. In Germany, the most recent person who died was in 2014 using a mechanical, excavator on a building site and set off a bomb. People in Western Europe, which were very, very, very heavily bombed, are not dying as a result of barbecues. So there's definitely something that could be done at scale to reduce the significant problem with unexploded ordnance here. So yeah, I mean, if money was no object, I'd like to have 1,000 staff working in multiple sites, clearing up those battlefield sites, clearing the ravine, that very poor area on the outskirts of town, clearing new areas for housing, etc. So I think there's a lot of potential there. And it would be, it'd be very fulfilling to complete that task.
Could you talk just a little bit more about the people we do employ and just the Solomon Islanders themselves? Since I think Americans we have some people on the line who have had experiences with the Solomon Islands, but I think most Americans haven't met them. So what's it like working with our counterparts there?
So it's a pleasure to work there. It's a pleasure to work there. I was talking to someone the other day who's working in Yemen and was talking. They've done a presentation about the Solomon Islands in Yemen to the Yemenis. And the Yemenis were saying, but who's in opposition to you? Where do you have a problem with the national authority? Who is your enemy? And it's like, well, there really aren't any enemies there in the Solomon Islands, which makes, of course, it much easier to do the task, which doesn't mean to say Yemen doesn't need a lot of help. It does. But in the Solomon Islands, we can work very well. Our staff are educated. There's a good education system in the Solomon Islands, and they're very passionate about the job. We have 50-50 male-female. You've seen pictures of Asina, for instance, already. It's a courteous culture. It has some elements that reminds me of Southeast Asia. People are polite to each other. They like to sort of think the best of each other. So it doesn't come across as aggressive unless you sort of head out late at night downtown, which I wouldn't advise. But it's a, you know, it's a pleasure to work there. It's very noticeable though that it, you know, it suffers from being a very long way away from anywhere. It's very heavily contaminated with UXO. It has, I think, the most expensive electricity in the world. At the moment, it's just diesel generators are running all the electricity across the islands. You know, they need waves, they need wind, they need solar. You go to the shops and it's basically whatever's come in on a ship recently. So the local product, you know, fish is, of course, local, and there's tons of fish, and that's fantastic. So you can eat some really good fish. Tend to eat it with cassava or the local potatoes. I'm very much enjoying working there with a team that is very motivated by the job ahead of them. And the public, when we encounter them, have been very cooperative, revealing information to us, leading us to items of ordnance in their gardens that they know about, etc. So there is a general sense that it's welcome work. And then, of course, we're branded US government because it's being funded by the US government. And so it's a good, I think it's good outreach for the US government to be seen to clearing up its mess. And so I don't get much, well, hang on, why is this so late? I get more of a, oh, fantastic, you've come. I think probably in the capital city, maybe it's a bit more cynical, but when you get out and about in the regions, in the provinces, very heavy contamination, people are just very pleased to see us.
Interesting. And you mentioned that our Yemeni colleague saying, you know, who's the enemy in this effort to do good work? You know, ultimately indifference is the enemy here, that we as the United States, as you said, you know, took great power competition for us to care about this in 1942. Once the Japanese were pushed away, we moved on. There wasn't a Marshall plan for the Pacific Islands because there wasn't a Soviet Union knocking at the door. But now we've got China. You know, that's the reason the U.S. government is focused on this, is that you've got the Chinese who built that Pacific Island stadium that you showed us. We've got them concluding a security agreement with the Solomon Islands government. I personally like to think of this is one of the hopeful things, one of the good things that can come out of this new phase of great power competition that is so worrying. You know, we can sit there and worry about what a new war might mean if the fight over Taiwan were to become a hot war instead of a competition behind the scenes. But one of the good things, one of the few good things about renewed great power competition, is that the U.S. government cares about this place. And I think we should have cared about it all the way from 1945 on forward, because these are people with dignity and lives and who fought with us and who saved John F. Kennedy. But if we can use that now, if we can mobilize that you know, attention to make, you know, life better for the 600,000, 700,000 people who live there, then that's a good thing. We've had some great comments on the line. I know that Douglas Anderson has had a number of comments, and I would love anyone to see them. I want to associate myself with them. He's, he's mentioned, you know, why didn't we as the United States get out there and do this early on? I certainly agree with that. And you've got other great observations, Douglas. For me, when I joined Simon and we were out at the Russell Islands, where you see that beautiful young kid in Asina in that picture that Simon showed us, that's actually where John F. Kennedy was first based. His first PT boat base was on the Russell Islands, and it became this gigantic ammunition depot. And you can see where the soldiers and sailors, you know, who were given about 2 weeks to leave, you know, when the war ends. And for a while, they were just trying to pitch the artillery shells into the ocean. And you can see them kind of trailing into the water as you pull up in your boat. But then they got out of there. You know, they just moved on. It was too big of a job to do. And now you've got little kids like her walking through on top of these artillery shells. Who knows if the next one might be one of those white phosphorus shells that, if it has a rusted casing and it gets exposed to the air, you're burned alive by it. You know, it just seems so such an easy win for the United States to do the right thing, given that kind of background that you mentioned, Simon. The fact that people aren't saying, why weren't you here earlier? They're saying, thank you for coming. we're competing with China that builds stadiums. We're not going to be able to spend hundreds of millions of dollars on stadiums, but if we can make it, you know, safe for a kid to go to school and harvest coconuts with her family and not worry about stepping on a white phosphorus shell that might explode beneath your feet, that seems like a good thing to do. Well, that's the last of my soapbox. I don't see any more questions on the line, but I am going to double check. And seeing none, Simon, perhaps you could just share you know, your last thoughts here. I really appreciate what you've shared with us, but if you have any parting thoughts before we let our great participants go on with their day.
Yeah, I mean, I think that this, you know, the great power competition creates an opportunity, and there's an opportunity not just for the Solomon Islands, but across the whole of the Pacific to properly map and identify the locations of ordnance, the kind of casualties, the area, the hotspots, the areas that are most problematic. You know, I talked to you about that battle in Tarawa, you know, so Kiribati now, you know, that area. Papua New Guinea, some very savage fighting between Australians and the Japanese, and also the location of the big Japanese logistic base at Rabaul. I think there's a lot of work to be done. I think the model of what we're doing, you know, which is a gradual one, which is survey, accident data, and then in due course clearance, that's the way to do it. I know there's always a pressure on clear, 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 but we really do need to work out which bits need to be cleared first, because, you know, it's a slow, laborious process. And if we don't have 1,000 staff, I can't clear every single bit of it. So I think there's a great opportunity there. I think it's a good news story, particularly for the United States. I think the people of the Solomon Islands and the people of the South and Central Pacific deserve the assistance.
Said on the front end, Simon is actually an American citizen and a UK citizen. His accent sounds a little bit more UK than California, but we're really lucky, you know, as Halo USA, to have him leading the charge and wearing that American flag on his you know, left shoulder there, and you know, bringing this message. This is a great story of the U.S. doing the right thing, albeit a little bit late, but doing the right thing. And I do think that for anyone on the line who has advocated for our work, advocated for the work of the entire sector clearing landmines and explosives, who advocates on the Hill for conventional weapons destruction, the component of the U.S. budget that funds this stuff, I want to thank you. I think this is a perfect example of this is something that we can do that saves lives and advances human dignity, but it's also American public diplomacy. It's a story of our values. And having that American flag out there saying, we didn't forget you. Sorry, it took us so long to get here, but we care and we want to be part of your future. So thank you, everybody, for joining us. And I look forward to connecting again. Thanks again.
Thanks, Luke.